Welcome back. This is Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today we're having the pleasure of speaking with Michaela Martens.
I really want to know soprano, mezzo-soprano, the difference now in your heart during that period of time and now.
When I started singing, the quality of the sound is very sort of Slavic sounding, and people really just assumed, because of the texture and the quality, it was a soprano voice. I think probably what I was then is a soprano, but a Zwischenfach soprano, somebody who doesn't sing so high. When I began making this transition and I started to understand my body and I started to understand how to support and how to breathe. That's where Ruth Falcon came into the mix, really. Everything just felt more relaxed. And what being a mezzo allowed me to do was to be an artist the way I wanted to, because I had the technical proficiency to do what I needed to do to convey feelings and emotions and temperament. And I just, frankly, I don't think I understood how to sing when I was a soprano. I think I was winging it half the time. But I was always a very convincing actor. So what I couldn't sing, I could act. The best advice I ever got was from Rosalind Elias, who said to me, you know, when the voice is gone, darling, you act. I really lived on that for a long time. But once I started to understand how to sing technically, everything got more relaxed. The body, my voice got deeper. My body was more relaxed. And because it got deeper and I was more relaxed, more high notes happened. But I could really then use my body as a vessel and an instrument to convey what I wanted to as an actor.
So you're free.
Yeah, you bet. Yeah, because there's one thing to feel it in your heart and to know what you want to do and not be able to execute it. But once I started to understand how to be a singer and how to do it well and right, I could meld those two. After being at Juilliard and studying with the late Frank Corsaro, God rest his soul, was such an amazing teacher, because he was relentless and unforgiving. He would not accept an opera singer who stood and sang, devoid of emotion or intent. He wouldn't accept it. He was a method actor. So as close as you could come to being a method actor and an opera singer at the same time was his goal. He didn't feel the art form was, you weren't complete if you didn't do both those things. And I couldn't do both those things until I understood how to use the instrument, you know?
All these heavy, dramatic roles we've been talking about, are there some, do you do some comedy? Are there some, do you get a change of pace where you go off and do someone who's just fun and funny?
Rarely, but I have done Marcellina, mm-hmm. and I loved it. And that was in Santa Fe, my first summer in Santa Fe. And I sometimes get to do, but they're not written for me. You know, it's like compromario parts aren't necessarily written for my fach, you know. But there are some.
What about Quickly?
I could do Quickly, but somebody would have to do it and give it to me.
That would be fun to do.
It would be fun to do, actually.
But you live with the strong yeah. ladies. Now, I have some experience with you on a recent venture of yours where you sang for the first time Clytemnestra. Mm. And you learned it very quickly, which you have done with many roles. Mm. You must have gotten a good, solid music training to be able to learn a role just musically so quickly.
I learned how to do that. I didn't. At the University of Washington, there wasn't much training to that effect. But when I got to Juilliard and I realized that all these kids who'd come from Eastman School of Music who were so proficient, and even the kids who'd come out of the undergrad program at Juilliard who could sight read because of Mrs. Cox, who was the sight singing teacher there, I realized I was really deficient in this area. I couldn't sight sing anything, not even like a perfect fourth so I spent a lot of time, and I got some great advice from a singer friend of mine, Shari Gruber. She heard me in a practice room plunking out notes, and she poked her head and said, what are you doing? And I said, I'm playing my part. She said, don't do that. Sightseeing your part, force yourself to do it. Even if it takes you three times as long, force yourself to do it. So I got good at it. But now, you're right, I'm kind of developing a reputation for being able to learn something in a week to 10 days.
That's dangerous.
Which I'm dangerous a little bit.
Yes. So when you have such a short time, explain in short form, what is the way you do this? What are the steps? What comes first? How do you do it?
You helped me with this, actually. I used to just sit down and power my way through it. And it seems like a quicker way. It's not. What I start with is I speak it all in rhythm. And we did that a lot in our sessions. And I speak it all in rhythm. And then sometimes I even, if it's Czech, I take the words out and speak the rhythms of the notes. And then I plug the Czech in. And then I go to the notes. If I can do that way, it goes in relatively quickly. If I try and skip steps and don't do that, it's much harder. And the other thing I do is I find myself with an accompanist who will help me hear the chord structure underneath. And we've done that together, and I have another wonderful pianist that helps me hear, because I hear chords. If I can hear the chord, I can almost always figure out where I'm headed.
Where it's going.
But that's from my grandfather, who was, you know, a big band musician. He didn't read music. He played chords. So I have very vivid memories of my father and my uncles and my grandfather playing, and my grandfather would just shout chords and they'd all make chord changes together. And that's how they played. So, I hear that way. It's the quickest way for me to get it into my head. After that, I can learn all the notes, but then begins the big project of trying to make it a person, trying to make it a life. You know, Kostelnička has to have a life. She has to have memories, and she has to have, you know, ideas of what her future is going to be, and it has to have this whole big structure around those notes. Otherwise, how is an audience who doesn't speak Czech going to understand what I'm doing? Yeah.
Your parents, they watch you going through all these. What do they say to you during the time?
Well, they've both passed on now, but my mother was so proud, and it was something she aspired to, but it's a hard road, and my father the same, so proud. He was my first director, so I learned the bones of what I do from him, but I can remember when my father passed away going through his things, and I didn't know he did this. Of course, you can discover things like this, right? There were boxes of clippings and programs, and if he wasn't at a performance, he had somebody send him something. Mm-hmm. Just amazing that he kind of kept all of this tucked away for me. It's just so amazing. They were very proud. Mm-hmm. And there is that thing, you know, you surpass your parents or whatever, you go on. They stopped at a certain point, and so to see me.
Do you think your mom sort of lived through you?
Oh, I do.
Yeah?
I do. I think, but I also think for them it was very scary with you know, they see me on the stage at the Metropolitan Opera. That feels really scary for them. At right. the same time, they're super proud of that. Mm-hmm. But I do think, there's a little.
They're probably more nervous than you are.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh, my father. My sisters had to flank him on either side. He'd get so nervous. Mm. But it was very, very sweet.
So this latest triumph, if we may call it that, the Clytemnestra in San Francisco. Tell us about that experience.
18 minutes of music.
Mm-hmm. A short sing for you.
A very short sing. A very short sing. But in terms of conveying all you can about this life, it's the pivotal moment in the opera. It's the whole reason the opera happens, is this woman. In getting into San Francisco, I was filling in for, our wonderful friend Stephanie Blythe. And when you walk into those shoes, You can't screw it up, like, and you have to bring all I had in me, because I was also walking into an incredible cast: Christine Gerke, Adrian Pajonka, who's these are their signature parts. So there was a lot of weight on that, and 10 days to do it. Mm-hmm. It wasn't even 10 days. was 6 days, 7 days.
It's very short.
A very short period of time. But so I had no idea of how to sculpt this life. I knew the notes. I just didn't know how to create a person or create a woman. And that...
It's a very complex person.
Yeah, very complex person.
You're going to sing the same role somewhere else soon, right?
Yeah. I leave on... I go to Houston to do it again with Christine Gerke. And then I have it in the books and other places after that. But, yeah, I feel like it's 18 minutes of something you'll keep learn. I'll keep learning about every time I do it. There'll be a new facet of this woman.
We have less than 1 minute of the 18, but let's take a look at a very short clip from San Francisco.
Okay.
Es drückt mich nicht. Es fügt mich nicht. Nichts ist es. Nicht einmal ein Alp. Und dennoch.
Wow. Nice little ditty.
Crazy woman.
Crazy she is. How did you deal with that emotionally? Wasn't it hard to keep saying?
Yeah, those scenes with Christine came out. We did that in a rehearsal. That was not directed, and it just happened. It just unfolded, and the closer I got to her, to whispering in her ear, was a very... there's an acting exercise, an animal exercise. It was very slithery. It was very snake-like and very, you know, to kind of get inside her and weave around a little bit. And it happened. Christine and I have known each other for 25 years. So there's a huge level of trust that we can do anything and risk anything. And it's, you know, it's like playing a great game of tennis. And we discovered this relationship kind of on our own. There's a couple of moments where she would chase me across the stage and put her hand on her back and throw me to the floor. It all just happened kind of organically. Mm. I think when you have a good partner, it just does that. You know?
It must be very gratifying.
Very, very. And the fact that we could be laughing hysterically, tears streaming down our face on a break, and then turn into that. I mean, that's real friendship, you know. And I have that with people who've been doing this with me all this 25 years that I've been doing it, you know. You grow up together in a way. To watch her work, to watch her things just come out of her. And sometimes it surprises her, sometimes she doesn't know. But stuff just... And then if you're on stage with that and you have a chance to react to that, it's just a... huge bonus.
What did you say to each other afterwards?
She said to me, every single night we would come off and we were waiting for our bows. She'd get her water because it's that massive scene at the end. She'd come up and stand behind me, wait for a bow, and come up, usually kiss me on the cheek or grab my hand and say, good job, Mama. And then that, off we go. Mm. Right? Yeah, it's old friendship, yeah.
Any career choices that you've made that you today look back and wish you would have made different choices?
Yes.
Yes, please.
To go to work from Goldman Sachs.
Yeah, I loved my time at Goldman Sachs, actually, and I learned so much about it. And I still have my bosses.
You're talking about real life.
Friends of real life, yeah. But I, in terms of repertoire and things like that, I would pay attention to when people told me that the marshalling was hard and I needed more than 3 weeks to work on it. I would probably not sing Don Elvira.
Why so?
I didn't understand the woman, and I've come to realize that if I can't understand the woman or relate to something in some way or tell her story, I shouldn't do it. And I couldn't figure out a way to tell her story. And I couldn't relate to her as a person. So I tried 3 times.
Why is this one especially?
I didn't understand her her relationship with Don Giovanni, and I could never make sense of a woman who would stay for that, who would tolerate that. I just never, I get it in theory. I just couldn't make it work.
So in other words.
And it made, therefore made it vocally almost impossible to sing Mitra Di. Because if you have to make sense of, for me, it has to make, had to make sense. And that's what Clytemnestra, once I made sense of her, her sort of abusive alcoholic world, then I could do it. But I couldn't.
Do you think it because you are fighting with yourself?
I do, in a way.
You're fighting with that character because you wouldn't do that.
No, right. And to be a really good actor, you can't judge that. You can't stand on the outside and say, well, I wouldn't do that, so I'm not going to do that. You have to kind of get in it.
Get into it.
And accept the circumstances you're given. But I tried three times, and I just was never good at it. I was never successful at being able to live that life for 3 hours or whatever.
But it's not Mozart. It was because, I mean, no. The reason was not Mozart. Because other, like, what Mozart roles do you like to sing?
Oh, loved to sing the Countess. Because there was, I really could make sense of that, and there's such a touch of bitterness in that woman. And I loved the idea of the two operas, the Barber and the before and after concept of that. But it's not Mozart, because almost one of my favorite things to sit in the theater and experience is Mozart opera and Handel. But if I had to do it again, I would think twice about Donna Elvira. I've seen some extraordinary women do it, and I can't do that. So at some certain point, you have to admit your limitations and say, okay, I'm going to watch you do that. I'm not going to try that. But
you said something at the beginning of the interview about your singing at the Met for the first time, dancing and being free, and you couldn't just stand there and sing. Mm. Now, all these years later, we just saw you do a performance in The Mother of Us All, Susan B. Anthony. You have a very strong final statement to sing, aria, whatever, and you sang it practically without moving. Mm-hmm. Now, does this mean for all those years you learned how to sing just standing there, letting the voice speak, or what was the difference?
I think the difference is I had to be able to recognize freedom in my body even when it was still. And the only way I could feel free is to move it. But I think it was me sort of externalizing all of the dancing things that I felt on the inside about the music, especially with the balatella. When you run, you know, you hear that music and you want to move and you want to dance around and you want to, but you have to. I needed to accept the stillness of music and know that my body didn't have to be in motion with the tunes, mm-hmm. that didn't mean constriction. For me, it always, always, always comes back to what I'm trying to say as a character. So I could stand and sing because of all of the things that she was saying at the end, you know? Do you know because I tell you so, or do you know? You know, the things that she was saying had a very, the line itself had a lot of motion to it, so I didn't need to move my body because the air was moving for me. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you think something got to do with honest?
Yeah, I do. I do. A great question, but I do. I think it's always, for me, this thing that you're talking about now was such a long thing to sing. It was such a big opera, and I sang so much of the night. But learning it in the studio, some of that is impossible to sing. Because you're just trying to sing it and not trying to experience it or tell a story. The minute you stop trying to tell a story, everything becomes twice as hard to sing. If I keep telling a story all the time, and maybe that's the answer to your question. So I could stand still because I was still telling a story. Mm-hmm.
But you also do recital and concert.
I do.
Right?
Yeah.
Do you like that better?
I love that. Nope. I need my costumes and my orchestra. Uh-huh. And I prefer the whole thing. I prefer the whole experience, the whole, the acting, yes. The sets, mm-hmm. The orchestra. I prefer the whole thing.
To lose yourself on stage.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's the Susan B. Anthony, Mother of Us All. When I was doing it, I couldn't feel tired. I didn't feel physically tired. But at the end of the night, I would call from my car and say, start the bathtub, put the Epsom salts in. Because I was so sore from running around and holding tension in places I wouldn't normally.
Yeah. Being an artist, when sometimes you are in it, you kind of lose in that world.
Yeah.
And you totally don't remember your exhaustion.
No, and that happened in the death of Klinghoffer. The last 10 minutes of that opera, and she breaks down in hysterics and has to sing the end of it crying. That happened in a rehearsal. That's not written in the score. That just happened when we were working on it. And it happened naturally, and he wanted to keep it. So then that meant that I had to get myself to that emotional pitch every time. You know, that's the journey the director wanted this woman to travel. So now I'm locked into it, right? Mm-hmm. In a way. But yeah, you lose yourself, and you tell a story to the best of your... That's what I loved about Lorraine Hunt Lieberson, is that she just told a story. And I remember hearing her, I don't know if it was in an article, but hearing her say that she didn't do a lot of interviews because she didn't want people to see her or hear her when she was singing Bach. She wanted people to hear Bach or Berlioz or whatever. And I think that when you get into this and you lose yourself in it, then people don't see me.
Right.
I hope. Yeah.
With all this drama and seriousness, if you have a couple of days off, what do you turn to? What relaxes you?
I can things.
I
make applesauce and pickles and peaches and pears and tomato sauce because I live in the country. So I put up food and I cook like crazy. I cook a lot.
Very therapeutic.
It is very therapeutic.
On that note, I think we better stop. I'm getting hungry. We've got to stop. So we've had a great pleasure talking to you, Michaela.
Thank you so much
for coming into town and speaking with us.
Thank you.
This has been Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today, we've had the great pleasure of speaking with Michaela Martens.